Hachette Audio presents The Girls of August, written by Anne Rivers Siddons, read by Kate Redding. To Allison, with dearest love. Prologue. Of all the 15 summer houses, the first one was the best. That's what we all agreed on, for a while anyway, until we grew wiser, more measured in our joy, more careful with the doling out of praise. Funny, we rarely agreed unanimously on anything, but for years there had been no doubt about the Colleton house. At first glance, it had seemed designed brick, board, and shingle for the girls of August. A silly name for four women who, after a decade and a half of never missing an August together, were adrift in middle age, fretting over crow's feet and reaching for skin cream. It had seemed silly to us even when we were in our 20s, when one of our husbands, had it been Mac or Oliver, no one could remember, coined it the first summer we'd taken a beach house together, back when our men were still residents in med school. We were not girls even then. Strictly speaking, I don't think some of us ever were. But it had been August, and somehow after that first time it always was. Odd how that week, the second week, to be exact, because it gave us time to breathe before school and fall and the holidays, had cemented itself into our lives.
"It's like Christmas, or goddamned New Year,"
Mac had said once, when we had been invited by his friends the Copleys to spend the first 2 weeks in August aboard their yacht, the Spindrift, cruising from Savannah to the Bahamas and back.
"Why the hell can't y'all just move it forward or back? I'll never get another chance to fish for a solid 10 days.
He blinked his eyes, a sure sign, I had come to learn over the years, of his being desperate to have his way. "We just can't," I said, not knowing why, only that we couldn't. It felt to each of the girls of August as if the universe would tilt on its axis, and no one would be the same if we adjusted the timing of our yearly gathering. "That's just when it is. We've already rented the house. Go fishing with the Copleys, by all means. I'll bet La Serenissima has a dozen itsy-bitsy teeny-weeny bikinis." Max snorted. Serena Copley in a bikini would have been as ludicrous as a hippo in a wetsuit. She was not fat, but at 6 feet and with shoulders as wide as a linebacker's, she packed more muscle than Arnold Schwarzenegger. She was, as her dandelion frail husband Dave said frequently, every inch an athlete.
"She could easily tow the boat in her teeth," Mac groused.
But he went fishing, and I went, happily, to the Gulf Coast of Alabama. In the early days, we always chose a spot along the northern Gulf Coast because it was within shouting distance of Nashville and Vanderbilt's med school, where, as Rachel was fond of saying, we were all stationed, as if life in med school was akin to military service. Given the long hours residents kept and the often life-or-death decisions they had to make, her military illusion bore some merit. But back to that first trip, taken in haste, almost hysteria, because the girls had wanted, I suppose, to claim time as fiercely as our men did. Beautiful Point Clear, Alabama. The house had belonged to Teddy's first wife, Cornelia, who would ultimately leave Teddy a few months after he went into private practice for a college boyfriend whose family boasted as much money as her own, taking her wonderful beach house with her. Let me be clear. We did not mourn Cornelia. I don't think even Teddy did. She was a lazy, drawling aristocrat whose sole persona seemed to be heavy-lidded amusement at the likes of the rest of us. But for a good long while, we sorely missed her rambling, gray-shingled beach house, with its endless airy rooms reminiscent of a Ralph Lauren ad, surrounded by a picket fence drooling Rosa Rugosa,
and dipping its feet into the warm green sea. We all took turns finding the next August's beach house, but we perpetually complained that none were as house beautiful perfect as the Colletons. Perhaps our affection for the place was like a first love. It takes the long view of history to snuff out the glow. "Old Mobile money, you know," Teddy had said asininely when he first introduced his rich golden girl to the rest of the group. I, unfortunately, had already met her, but that is another story. She officially came into the group fold, as it were, on Mac's birthday. I'd cobbled together enough champagne and crepe paper to throw him a proper party in our cramped apartment that was within walking distance of the hospital. "How nice for you," I'd purred to Teddy. None of us had much money. The guys, of course, were still residents. The idea of their finding practices to join or trying to start their own was nothing but a distant dream. Only Mac and I were married then, newlyweds full of blush and blather, though Rachel and Barbara were very much in the picture. Their weddings to Oliver and Hugh followed soon after ours. "Madison, dear, don't worry. We'll wait till the fuss about yours dies down," Cornelia had said silkily, just after our wedding, a champagne glass sparkling in her exquisitely manicured alabaster hand. "I'd hate for Teddy's and mine to be upstaged by the memory." "Yeah, right," Rachel had whispered in my ear in her froggy New Jersey voice as she made her way to the canapes, which I'd made myself, sacrificing sleep but gaining pride. "You wait," Rachel growled. "Hers will upstage Di and Charles's." And in many ways, I thought that it had. Their wedding was held on a late spring day on the lush emerald lawn of the house on Point Clear, against the backdrop of rioting Rosa rugosa and green waves curling onto pearl-white sand, with 8 bridesmaids, none of us among them, dressed in billowing blue tulle, and Cornelia herself in layers of diaphanous white silk that blew in the rose-scented wind like the petals of a flower. Teddy, startling in a cutaway and wickedly starched collar, looked as if the wind might pick him up and whirl him into Mobile Bay. He was so pale that his relentless 5 o'clock shadow stood out like a pirate's beard, although I was sure he had shaved hardly an hour before. He seemed tossed like flotsam in the sea of silks and satins and flowers and wondrous huge-brimmed hats that surged around him. I stood with Rachel and Barbara, our men were Teddy's groomsmen, and realized that I had seldom seen him in anything but green scrubs. This, sadly, was not an improvement. But oh, the house! That wonderful wind-riding, sea-drinking house. When it became clear that our group, which was surviving the rigors of med school thanks to inky coffee and catnap stolen on the fly, would inevitably be blown asunder by the advent of far-flung job opportunities, no more Nashville, no more "I'll be right over" when one of us was in crisis, Rachel, Barbara, and I had determined that a week-long getaway, possibly a yearly one, was in order. The men's residency schedules, we knew, would eventually be overtaken by careers and the detritus of life. So one late Friday night, as we chatted around a table cluttered with empty wine bottles, we insisted that no matter where the future took us, we would reserve 1 week for ourselves. "Always and forever," I had said. "Hear, hear," Barbara and Rachel had chimed in unison, and to seal the deal, we clinked glasses. Cornelia, who in addition to being transparently beautiful in the way of fair-headed blondes, was inordinately nosy, so she caught on to our harried plan in nothing flat. Not to be left out, she offered her summer house for free. Of course, that meant she would join us, but we could handle that. We could deal with her old money mannerisms and, we naively thought, perhaps make her a better woman. Sadly, the Colletton manse, as soon as we laid eyes on it, became the standard by which we judged all the subsequent getaway houses. Under the spell snobbery sometimes casts, we would find a perfectly lovely summer home and spend much of our week carping that it wasn't as pitch-perfect as Cornelia's. Even though some were warm and happy houses, and some, frankly, dreadful like the one on the Outer Banks that had oil drums and a defunct gas pump behind it, Cornelia's home stalked our imagination.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.